Okay, we are going on to Facebook Live.
Can I set my exposure?
Well, you can set your exposure while we're on live, because we're on live.
We're live.
Yeah. For a few of you caught the...
That's better, right? Is that good enough?
No, now it says... Now it says we're not on live.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Sort of know what I'm doing. Let me make sure I'm still recording. I've been recording for the last 37 minutes.
You can stop now. Start over.
Laying down a nice track.
Okay, I think we're on live now.
Let me see.
It started and then it...
Save project as. Ham Radio Now. When Marty... Yeah, you're live.
Okay.
Podcast.
So a few of you saw a brief Facebook Live thing. Yeah. And then, because I was having trouble making things work, I made it go away. So this is not a Ham Radio Now show.
This is a Facing Live.
Even though if you look down here, if you look
right there.
Down here, it says Ham Radio Now.
Right there.
Wait, I can let you do it. There you go. Yeah, over there. Using my new titling capabilities. You know, I could go bring in a Phasing Line logo and stick it there, but...
Do you already have one in the system? No,
not in the Wirecast system. It's over across the way.
I haven't been around enough, you know. If I was around, you know...
Yeah. Are we on Phasing Line now?
We were. Is this the right file? No, this is not the right file. Close this file. You told me to stop recording, and I screwed myself up.
Sorry. There you go. Apologize.
It's all Gary. Okay, I am laying down. Okay, I'm lying down, Jack. This is the Phasing Live podcast. What was the number I said in Dayton? Episode 12?
12. Every episode
from now on
is 12.
Yeah. Episode 12. This is the Phasing Live episode. We're going to call... You know, I think I'm just going to title every single episode. Episode 12. And
it's a good number.
Yeah. It's how old I feel half the time. You know.
You're too young to be feeling old.
Very.
You're supposed to say who you are.
Oh. Is that... I think people know who I am.
Well.
I'm Marty Selloway, KC1CWF. I'm Chicken with Fries.
And I'm Sterling Coffey, N0SSC.
And I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. No, I'm Marty. He is Gary.
I'm Gary.
This is the Marty Show. I'm kidding. This is the Phasing Line podcast. Phasing Line.
Sterling's going, what the heck?
.com. He's going to be like, where's my seat?
Yeah.
I just couldn't take you over Skype tonight. But that'll happen eventually. And I'm back. You know what 12 also is? I think it's probably the week since I've put out a show.
I was giving you static about that.
Were you?
Yes, on a previous show. I was I think it was on my title test when I was practicing how to make titles like this, which is not making any sense to your audience because they're audio.
Right. But he put up a title that says Ham Radio Now and then Chicken with Fries.
But yeah. Well,
makes him feel special.
They're built for my show. And I can put up one that's got me.
But you're not the producer, editor, or host, so take that
it's
one down.
It's built for my show.
All wrong, Gary. Begging for Funding Foundation.
Ham Radio Now is a proud member of the Begging for Funding Foundation.
Brought to you by beggars like you, yeah. Right?
Created Thank by you. Our chief financial officer, Arvin, and inspired by Bob Heil, K90ID.
Enough with that.
People have told me to lay off Bob.
I'm telling you to lay off Bob.
Okay. Okay, you too, huh?
Simmer. You know, check his show out too, hamradionow.tv.
Please.
So what's going on? I went away. I went to overnight camp. I took my phone. I handed it to my mother. I said, don't break this. And it's not a hammer. And it came back to me. And the video viewers will see it still works. It's still, it's dead right now. It won't turn on. But
so she didn't keep it charged.
Oh, she did. I just used
So we all want to know more about this camp.
Yeah. I went away to some super secret camp in Northwood, New Hampshire, which will sound awfully familiar to a lot of people in New England, because Northwood is actually the town over from the biggest ham fest around here, short of the Boxborough New England Division Convention. What was known as Hosh Traders back in the day, it is now Nearfest, is in the next town over in Deerfield. So New Englanders will know where that is. But, you know, no, I didn't do anything. Everybody always asks, you do radio things. No, I don't do radio things. But I did plenty of other stuff. You know, being outside, lighting theaters, keeping computers on, you know, fun stuff. I went hiking in Acadia National Park, rappelled off rock cliffs, and then had to climb back up to save my own life. Fun stuff like that. But radio stuff happens too, I guess. You know, I'm always afraid every year when I go to camp, am I going to get back and P5 was on the air and gone and I didn't get him and I'm never going to get him again. If you're on Gary's show, I think the technical director just pulled up a map there. But yeah, southeastern Maine.
Okay.
Yeah, southeast New Hampshire, excuse me. Not so far away from the ocean. A 20-minute drive, 30-minute drive. 30 minutes or so to Portsmouth, which is a beautiful town on the ocean.
Okay, so this was a low technology?
No technology. No technology.
Didn't have your phone?
Didn't have my phone. Had snail mail. Lots of people said, oh, I'll write you. Didn't get a single letter. Throwing all you guys under the bus.
You didn't call. You didn't write.
No, people just don't care, I guess.
You were logged on to Skype.
I left machines on. Yeah.
So what again? What did you do there? Did archery?
I couldn't.
Horseback riding?
Nope, not that one either.
Swimming,
boating, sailing, fishing.
Hello, Mata. Hello, what? Fada. Here he is at Camp Granada.
That was before my time.
Way before your time.
Feel old, Gary.
But the old hams know what it is.
Exactly. But you know, it's nice to get back to my radio friends. Slowly catching up. I have to go outside tomorrow and check out the antenna farm. The week before I left for camp, we had a terrible storm, and both of my 40-meter phased verticals came over, and there was a lightning event in the yard. So I don't think I have a feed system for my 40-meter verticals anymore. But we'll figure that out.
That's what they say. If it stays up, it's not big enough.
No, not big enough. But, you know, got to have something to do. Field day was right before camp. It always sticks because field day is on Sunday and I left on Wednesday. And,
And camp would be a perfect place.
All my gear is still in boxes. I have a couple bandpass filters that I need to retune. That's always fun.
Yeah. Did you say you were doing theater or something at camp?
I do technical theater. You know, I TD shows, technical direct, you know, call cues and hang lights and
stage theater.
Stage theater. But that's all a lot of fun.
Was this a musical?
I did two productions this year with a week between them. And 40 lighting fixtures to rehang between them.
And a cast of thousands?
And a cast of two. But I actually had a very good production assistant. So, you know. Pass me the Lico I put over there. Yes. Yes, Marty. Did you do your homework?
Marty!
Did you do your homework? Yes, Mother. I did my homework. I may or may not have picked up my summer reading the whole time I was there, but that's okay. But no ham radio. It's the perfect. I actually brought a ham radio one year, but
I mean, field day would have been great as a kickoff. Just, you know,
big
for a couple
fields,
days.
No noise.
And
you know, I listened to all the clear channel AMs in Boston. No issues.
How many happy campers?
350.
Yeah, you could have introduced them to a few of them to ham radio.
I brought a radio and a dipole last year, and I just didn't have any time.
Yeah, you need to set that up in advance.
Yeah, you know, it's as fun as it is to do something about, you know, throwing a rope over a tree and pulling up an antenna. It looks really embarrassing when you can't get the rope into the tree. And I'm not sure they'd feel if I brought an air cannon or a bow and arrow with a fishing line.
Well, I mean, just the little slingshot thing.
Yep.
The easy hang.
Easy hang. Not sure how easy hang is, but
that's pretty easy. Hang on. Do the show by yourself for a second. I'll be okay. Right back.
I can do my own show, but you know, that was fun. And getting back is always interesting, but I assure, I mean, the first thing I have to do, you know, check out the station. Are the antennas working? And that'll take a couple days. I think I'll go outside with a network analyzer tomorrow and just sweep everything. And, you know, one of the things I always tell people, especially people who have bigger stations or slowly building a bigger station, is document everything. Document the complex impedance of your antenna system when you build it. That way, you know, if you come back 3 months later and things are different, well, you know, there's probably something to look into. And that's exactly what I do here, you know. And I know what the antenna is supposed to look like, and then I can go in and, you know, check, and if something's not, I can troubleshoot. But if you don't know what your normal is supposed to be like, then...
What are we talking about now?
We're talking about setting up your station for the long run. If you don't know what your normal is like, and you haven't documented sort of...
You've forgotten how your station was set up?
No, I'm talking about antenna systems, and more importantly, you know, when you build an antenna, you really ought to get right down some measurements, and I'm not talking about SWR. I'm talking about the actual complex feed point. And the reason I kind of just told the audience, but I'll tell you again, Gary, is, you know, when you come back 3 months later, 6 months later, 3 years later, I know if something's wrong, you know, especially when you have something more than just a dipole. I can, on my phased arrays, I can have very good SWR, but all the power's going into the dummy load, maybe.
Or
one of the phasing lines isn't working right, and I don't have a pattern anymore.
Now I know why you call the show the phasing line.
There you go. but I always stress this. You document. What's your rotator control cable color code? You know how many times I've gone into a station and they don't have their dang color codes written down? Or they take the resistor color code and have to modify it and switch some wires around. Standardize, organize, label. It'll save you so much time.
Yeah. Random. I have become the guy in charge of audio studios and looked for any documentation left over by the people that built them. I hate working on what somebody else built. I'd much rather build it myself. And there is none. So I go trace every wire and draw the diagram of how it was put together, and then I can use it. Here's the easy hang.
Slingshot with a fishing line.
Slingshot with a Zebco spinner thing on the front, and I could probably put my eye out with this, or I could shoot this right into
one of the cameras,
a camera or a monitor, or as. As I when I was interviewing the Easy Hand guys at Dayton a couple times, they were on the other side of the wall from Yaesu, and they said, "You think we could drop one of these into the middle of the Yaesu booth?" The guy thought that was probably not a great idea. Maybe that was the beginning of my trouble with Yaesu.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe Dennis didn't like that so much.
Anyway, this is good for getting over 50, 60-foot tree. I've got 70-foot trees, and I can't quite make it over them, but.
You know, I'll tell you a really funny story about not labeling your cables. I once came into a similar environment, a radio station. And we had to wire up some RE20s, you know, what they have there. It might have, you know, standard broadcast mics.
It's the expensive man's PR40.
Yes. No, just the stubborn man's PR40. and I things were just not working. And, you know, I soldered the XLRs together and I realized the engineer, whoever built it, was swapping pin 2 and 3 on everything. I couldn't follow a color code. On one end of the cable would be one thing. On one end of the other, you had phasing issues. The whole thing wasn't working. Well,
if you swapped it on everything, you'd be okay. If you only swapped it on some things,
you're inverting phase between them. And that was the issue. It was absolutely terrible.
We had a great fun with that in the television business. In the late 70s. Maybe television switched from mono to stereo. And all of these television audio engineers didn't know anything about stereo. So now they were presented with audio boards and, you know, new equipment, all stereo. and they had to wire them all up, and they screwed up the phase all over the place. And there was a good long time. And the same thing with editors. You know, every piece of audio equipment in the television business had to be sterilized. And the guys who ran it didn't understand the problem with phase. So it would be funny. You would watch a TV commercial on the air, and the stereo music would come on, and everything would be fine. And then
the voice would come on, and it would sound there's like this.
Yeah.
You'd barely hear anything.
I watched, this is kind of, I'll name the guy because I know he knows better than this, and it was just a stupid mistake at the time. I watched an episode of a podcast that Alex Lindsay put out. He runs the Pixel Corps. He's a big shot in the production world. And
co-host on Mac Break Weekly on Twitch.
Yeah. Smart guy, knows his stuff in the industry, respected. Gary has a cough switch. I keep noticing that.
It's a cough cough pot. Whoops, there we go. There we go. Yeah. Sorry. I mean, I could do it as a switch, but the switch isn't lit up, so.
But I listened to one of his shows, and everything sounded absolutely terrible. And, you know, I potted all the audio to one side, and it immediately hit me. The two channels were out of phase. I listened to the left channel for like a big show he produced, but like a, you know, you read all the comments, out of phase, you know.
I worked at a radio station in Arizona for 3 months until they fired me back in the late 80s. And it was an AM station. AM and FM. And
simulcast?
Simulcast the morning show, and then it split. The FM was a satellite thing, and the AM was live and local. And the board had mono outputs and stereo outputs, and the I'm trying to remember exactly what the problem was, but the feed to the AM transmitter was just the left channel, and so most of the music that we played, not that big a deal, but there were a few songs that were very stereo, some Beatles stuff especially,
and way spread out.
Yeah, and so people only got the left channel, so not very good. And the boss was a ham, but he never bothered to fix it. It's too cheap.
I would say, you know, this is something, what we're talking about right now is, you know, you talk to any audio engineer, they understand it. Talk to like some audio, you know, apprentice, an assistant who's taping down cables. They might have said, understand it, but hams get it.
Yeah. He understood it. He knew what was going on. He
knew exactly what he was doing.
He told me it's just too cheap to fix it or too lazy.
Pulling cables is no fun. I'll tell you. I'll reminisce on one more story before we put everybody to sleep. I pulled Cat 6A through my school once for a new wireless system. We needed to pull some cable through the attic. Very hot, very sweaty, very unpleasant. And I had the other guy crimp the connectors on, and then I was just trying to test throughput, you know, from one part to the other. And I said, "Well, you know, the speed really sucks. You should see a lot more." He's using Cat 5 connectors. They're different connectors. You have to use real Cat 6 connectors. True story.
He was using what?
RJ45 is designed for Cat 5.
And so the connectors make that big a difference?
Connectors make a huge difference, especially when you start messing with IP audio. Dropouts, it's the real deal. It's more of a...
I've never put in a Cat 6. Everything here
Cat 5E.
Everything here is Cat 5. It's short, you know, 20 feet or so, and I get a gigabit through it.
Is it E or regular 5? You probably can't get a gigabit over regular 5.
I don't know. They put it in when they built the house. We should have wired the whole house for.
It's so much harder later.
Yeah, but we didn't.
That's how it goes. But, you know, I don't know. Do it right the first... I think if there's anything that this discussion has proved, it's do it right the first time.
Which means we should start the show over.
Well, we should
have done it right the first time. Well, you said you had no plan for the show, so just it's just random.
It's a rambling show.
Yeah.
You really like the rambling shows. Rambling shows make me nervous. You know, I never know what's going to come out of my mouth, especially when you have the live stream. It only makes it worse.
Yep. The thing I like about live is that when somebody asks you if you can, if they can change something, I'll say, well, sure. The signal right now, and this is for broadcast more than internet, but for broadcasting, the signal right now should be about, from the part you wanted to change, right now it is passing Jupiter. So if you climb in your rocket and you get out there really fast, then you should be able to make the changes you want before it reaches the people on Alpha Centauri.
And do that, they say, well, you know.
They've given me this
Where's
blank,
the dump button?
They give me this blank expression.
This is when 12-second delays and whatnot are very nice.
I have a delay story, too.
Oh, do you?
I was freelancing for a local public radio station, doing a national show, and sorry if I'm so flummy tonight, a national show, and we had a delay system, and the delay module was in a different studio, so I had to do a lot of running back and forth to get it set up and turned on and all that. And this is a health and medical related show. And they were going to do a show on sex. And the station manager was a little more concerned about the audience on that show than typical. So for the first time ever, we decided to test the delay. So we're sometime before the show starts. And we're just...
We better explain what a delay is here for the people who don't know.
Well, it's in this case, it's a digital audio delay.
It's
a buffer. Remember the stuff on the radio stations when somebody calls in and
they're really pissed off?
Well, no, and the host answers their call, and then you're hearing what the host just said 10 seconds before over the phone, because the person's listening on the phone, on the radio as they're sitting next to the phone. And you always hear, turn your radio down, turn your radio down. You don't hear that so much anymore. I think people have finally gotten used to the idea that if you're going to call into a show, you got to turn the radio down. Well, the producer will tell you, turn your radio down before they let you on the air.
So where's the delay story in here?
Well, so the general manager and I were sitting testing the delay, and I pushed the button that should have dumped the delay, and it didn't. I was in a remote studio, and the chief engineer wired up the delay, and I assumed that he tested it. I'd never bothered to test it. Pushed the button, nothing. Nothing happened. So, in fact, what we were going to do is we were going to rehearse what to do about the delay with the talent. Because
if something happens,
yeah,
press the button.
An engineer, basically what's going to happen is somebody calls up on the phone. And, you know, hello, welcome to the show. And they start screaming a bunch of obscenities or something. That's going to cost you a lot of money and fines. And so the engineer is going to, you know, push the button to dump it. Well, the engineer has got to be astute enough to turn the phone off before they push the dump. Otherwise, now the rant is going live on the air. So fade out, dump, cue the talent to start again.
Right.
And so I practiced the fade out, pushed the dump, nothing dumped, nothing happened. General manager freaks. And sits in the remote studio next to the actual delay box where she could push the dump button herself for the show, because we were doing all this 5 minutes before air, so, and it's a live show, of course. I got a million broadcast stories.
You didn't do that, but how many years? You weren't actually behind a microphone for that many years.
For me, being a disc jockey, it was about 4 months in 1970 in Door County, Wisconsin.
That was it?
For 3 months in Lake Havasu City, Arizona. And then I worked at a radio station while I was going to school in Central Illinois for a couple of years. It's the longest radio station job I ever had.
Largest job you've ever had.
Yeah, maybe. But it was an automated station. And so there's very little on the air. We were
How did automation work in the 70s?
Poorly. We had two tape decks with these giant platters, giant reels of tape, and they had all the music on them. And then two carousels for the cart machines that had the commercials on them. And so the song would end, a very rudimentary trigger would start a cart in one carousel, and then that commercial would finish and it would start a cart in the other carousel. By carousels, I'm literally talking about these round things that had like 30 cassettes in them. Cartridges. They look like 8-track carts, but the broadcast version. And so when one finished playing, the other started to play, and the first one would eject, and then the carousel would move one slot, and it would load the next one. And all that took about 20 seconds. So you had a 30-second commercial and 20 seconds to do that in, except that we had a lot of 10-second commercials. So you had to load them just right so that the first thing that played was the 10-second commercial, and then a 30-second and another 30-second. The sales department did a great job. That little station run lots of commercials. And what we would do, in addition to tending all of that, was record more commercials. So my voice was on tons of commercials. But I didn't get
to... You love hearing your voice on the radio.
I'm used to it.
You ever hear the voice of the roaming gnome anymore? Is that long
ago? Well, the roaming gnome is still on the...
is your voice still used at all?
No. They just have to pay me a lot to do that. Because that was SAG. That was SAG and AFTRA. Yeah. And I'm not even sure that the roaming gnome voice is the same guy that did it when I was doing it. It was a British comedian. His name was Harry Enfield. And he's famous British comedian. But not well known here. He'd done a few commercials over here.
Yep.
But I think that they've got someone different because the voice sounds a little different. They probably got kind of a sound alike guy. It would be cheaper. The ad agency that had that account when I was doing it lost that account and went to someone else. Oh. But they even if, when I was there, I wasn't the voice anymore for a long time.
Right. So let's bring this back to ham radio for a second. I've been gone.
Yeah, your license has been expired.
It lapsed, I'm now KCW. I don't know.
KCWF 12345.
Yeah. KC1CWF. Chicken with fries. I still have it in me. Barely.
I on field day.
What did you do for field? Let's talk about field day.
Well, I did a tour with the North Carolina section manager.
For the nth year in a row, no?
No, this is the first time I did it with him. And it's a show, and it's actually, I got it edited and got it online. And one of the places that we stopped was an old abandoned warehouse, but it's not abandoned because there were people in it. But an old mill, an old cotton mill warehouse that had a makerspace in it. And part of the makerspace was a little ham radio station. So, yeah, that was very, very interesting. And somebody put up on the Ham Radio Now Facebook group that space just burned down. And you can see this on Facebook Live, and you can see it on the video.
That's a pretty big fire.
Phasing Line podcast can't see it. If you look right down here, you can see a little blue door. That's the door. It's designed to be after the Doctor Who TARDIS. You ever watch Doctor Who?
Yeah.
So you recognize the blue door for the TARDIS. And the ham station, that's their door. And the ham station is just off to the right of it. And you can see... This is a drone shot. The fire is on the other side of the building. But if I go down the timeline a bunch, the whole building's involved.
Yeah, that's terrible.
So that's very sad. This is a very enthusiastic group And they had tons of equipment in it, not just ham equipment, but you know, all kinds of lathes and laser cutters and saws and drill presses, you know, all the mechanical, all the electrical, electronic. Nice classroom. They had done a ton of work, all did it all themselves. And it was called the Foothills Community Workshop. It's in a little town called Granite Falls, North Carolina. So it's gone.
Oh.
They pledged to rebuild.
That's terrible. I did field day. We did 3 Alpha, 3 America.
At camp?
Ants. No, before I camp starts on Wednesday. Field day was Sunday.
Instead. Oh, okay. So camp starts after field day.
Yes.
Okay. So who did you go with?
I went with, I ran the field day. the CCARC, the Clay Center Amateur Radio Club, back in Boston. It's a youth club. And they asked me to kind of run it for them. We did 3 Alpha plus a VHF and a GOTA station. My theme this year was simplicity. And that worked out to some extent. We had one.
Did you do it literally in a field?
It was literally in a field.
Literally.
The club made a connection with a another club which has some crossovers in leadership called NEAR, New England Amateur Radio. And NEAR has a broadcast, basically an ENG truck, if people don't know what ENG is, electronic news.
That TV truck that you see drive around town.
Yeah, the one with the big tall mast and the.
Yeah. You
know. So it's a Wolf Couch outfitted TV truck with a bunch of racks in the back. Let me see if I can pull up a picture. But anyways, I spent the year outfitting that. And the cool thing about that is, you know, I got a Cushcraft A3. Yeah, Cushcraft. Tri-band or 3-element trapped Yagi. Not the greatest.
So much for simplicity. Dipoles are simplicity.
Well, I wanted gain in an off-center fed dipole at 50 feet on the mast, and it worked really very well. And that was lovely. And okay, so let me do. I'm going to move this here. Let's make sure the pictures before I share my screen that I'm. Okay. And then I can, yeah, I'll show the drone shots and whatnot. Share screens.
I have drone envy. Jason, KC5, C. Suddenly I want to give him your call sign, CWF. From Ham Radio 2.0. Put up his field day video, and he's got lots of drone footage in it.
So let's see.
KC5HWB.
What is it? What is full screen? F11, right? There we go. Can you see that shot?
Yeah. Looks good. Let me get my bandwidth meter out of the way.
So that was our field day site. And I think this photo, I have a couple photos. I think I can switch between them. No, I can't. Can't do it in that shot, F11. So I'll talk about this first. So this was our field day site. You can see kind of the three stations almost. So you see my cursor, ham radio. Phasing lab people, I'm just going to have to kind of explain this by voice.
Okay, well, there's the little TV truck in the parking lot.
You see a TV truck in the parking lot.
And the mast.
Mast, tri-bander on it.
And you're next to a four-story building.
Four-story building.
With a bunch of antennas on top, but I'm assuming that's not ham radio.
Oh, good amount of it. Some Homeland Security, some police.
Oh, and there's
observatory.
Observatory on top.
But you'll see a couple things here. So first, in the right side of the picture, there's a big truck, the truck I just talked about, 40-foot mast, 50-foot mast with a tri-bander on top, and fully outfitted inside, and I'll show a picture of that in a second.
Is that Boston? Big buildings on the horizon?
Yeah. I'll show you a gorgeous drone shot of Boston in a sec. But then you see in the lower left of the photo a tent that held our 40-meter station. I had an interesting strategy.
By the way, if anybody wants to see this as we're describing it, it'll be on the Ham Radio Now Facebook group.
Yeah, I'll post all the pictures there.
Okay.
And then there's a tent in the lower left, and that's where we had our 40-meter station. And the way I did it this year is we knew we wanted to do the three stations, and we wanted lots of flexibility. So the station in the van could do any band 80 through 10. Phone, CW, RIDI, PSK. But primarily that was the digital and CW station. We don't have that many CW ops, so it mainly stayed on RIDI. And then the other two stations were dedicated to phone, because at this point in the solar cycle, there's really not that much 10-15. So what does that mean? That means during the day, your options are basically 20 and 40, in my opinion. And at night, your options are really 40 and 80, because 20 is basically a daytime band as we go down in the 11-year cycle. With some exceptions, but with small, low antennas and low power, that's generally a theme. So
well, we usually had there's some sporadic E.
Some. We had one good 10-meter opening.
Yeah. 15 was good Sunday morning, at least down here.
Not up here. You know, sometimes we get the, you know, the north-south path working because, you know, it's a lot easier to get a north-south path, strong north-south path over an east-west path.
East-west.
East-west path with thy oaths and thy curios. But anyways, we had a 40-meter dedicated station, which I thought worked out nice. And then the other station kind of switched between 20 and 80. That was fine. We ended up using the other the truck station on phone a couple times on 15 and whatnot and 10. But it primarily was a digital station. It did very well on 20 and 40 RIDI. And then we had a GOTA station with a couple dipoles and a VHF station with Yagis on 6, 220, 432, and 2 meters.
Did you get some GOTA ops?
And we got lots of GOTA ops. Because we're a youth club, we get lots of kids. We had a Boston police officer show up at 3:30 in the morning on the graveyard shift and ask if he could get on the air.
Cool.
On GOTA. So we promptly woke up somebody who was willing to go to coach. He was not very happy to wake up, but once he knew what he was doing, he was quite excited. And then let me see if I can pull up some other pictures here. There's a shot of our whole field day site. Here's just so you can see. I think this is a gorgeous shot. You can see our field.
What's this building again, or the complex?
It's all at a big, fancy private school.
Okay, that's a school. And,
it's a school. So you can see that the van is on a parking deck, and then we're kind of straddling two fields.
And it looks like you're up on a hill.
We are up on a hill.
We're actually way above Boston.
Yeah, it's actually a great location. It's actually considered a mountain. We have a repeater up on the roof, and it goes from high atop Mount Wally. This is the W1 CLA repeater. It's on a mountain, which is called Mount Wally. It's just a big hill. It sounds cool. Big slopes in all directions, but it's a very nice location and a gorgeous view from the roof of the building. You can see the whole Boston skyline quite nicely. So this shot kind of shows you just where we are and how close to Boston we are, actually. Let's see if there's any other good photos here. You can see I'm just going to stay here so I can toggle back and forth. You can see our GOTA station, ICOM 7300s everywhere. We went all ICOM this year. There was our VHF station with somebody getting on, I think, what was 6-meter sideband. There's one tired Marty confused and dazed.
Proving that you were there.
Proving that I was there. There's our truck up close and personal. It was a cool shot. iPhone shot, as you can see, vertical. I'm going to post all these.
That looks like a lot of antenna for a very slender mast.
That mast is actually weighted for 250 pounds of vertical load. When I got it, it had a dish on it.
Well, yeah.
And a dish has a lot more wind load than a Yagi. Because if you think
depends
about
on the size, but.
You think about a 3-foot dish. If the wind's blowing, that surface, there's a lot more surface area than a flat, skinny.
Yeah, if it's turned into the wind. I guess the TV station's got to turn it toward wherever their receiver site is.
It worked fine. It felt very, very stable. Let's see. There's the truck deployed before I put everything together, and that I made the antenna. I modified it so it can go up quite quickly. Let's just see. What else do we have here? There was our whole team posing for field day. You could see me with the incident commander.
That's a big group.
Yeah, we had quite a few people. It was quite exhausting. Let's see. There's the shot.
That's cropped, your QSL color, card.
Cropped and color corrected. I think that's there's our van when it broke down on the way to the field day site. We had to call AAA. It turned out the person driving it did not realize that the gas gauge that he thought was dysfunctional really worked fine. It was just at zero.
So it didn't break down, just ran out of gas.
Didn't break down. There's the van. There's the van when I was in the middle of outfitting it. But we have a big patch panel on one side, patching all those coaxes, and then some VHF, and then there's some DMR radios in it, and ICOM 7300, a 706, a couple computers. The station generally works quite nicely. And now that it's done, I mean, I'm not sure, do I have a more current photo? I might. The station really turned out nicely.
What's its main job in life?
So we kind of set it up to do just about everything. That's why you'll see things like the patch panel that we added. Because it's really, the first thing you do, in my opinion, when you design a vehicle or when you design any sort of a piece of equipment, is the first thing you have to do is identify the mission. What is this going to do? What purpose do I serve? What gear do I need to accomplish that mission? If you don't have a mission when you're starting, you already failed. That's just me. Gary, you might disagree. But I think identifying a mission and then figuring out what tools you need to meet your mission before you even spend a dollar is very important. But when we sat down and identified our mission, we realized that our mission wasn't just one mission. We wanted to be doing everything from, net control for a marathon to remote contesting like this, be it VHF contesting or HF contesting, to MCOM deployments. So we really set everything up to be flexible. We currently have it set up for sideband AM FM from 160 through 432. And we're going to go higher over time.
So your mission was every mission.
Well, not every mission, because you have to optimize for certain missions. If you say you can't, you can do everything pretty crappy. You can do certain things well, or you can do one thing really, really, really well.
Well, your space inside is limited. So it looks like, one or two person operation.
We have three half racks of gear. We also have the ability to patch out. One of the things that's pretty cool about most modern VHF and UHF radios is that most of the front panels are just Cat 6, Cat 5, RJ45 connectors, detachable front panels. And we've set it up so I can actually leave all the RF in one vehicle and then use a Sprinter van that we have. Let me see if I can grab a picture of that. That Clay Center amateur radio has not near. And then just go ahead and deploy the actual operators in the other vehicles with the front panels going to the RF decks in another vehicle. We've actually done that, and it works quite nicely.
Simplicity.
I mean, it's fairly simple stuff. I'm not sure if you've seen MCOM 1 before.
Yeah. Orlando, saw it at Dayton.
So one of the things we wanted to avoid when we designed the vehicles, there's no automatic switching system. There's no automatic bridging controllers. There's no, everything that might be hard to, there's no relays that need to be connected for one radio to work. That's a double-edged sword. You lose some power and some flexibility, but you also get reliability and mission and be able to adapt to a lot of missions. And that was important for us.
Yeah. So its capabilities are HF.
VHF.
Do you have a screwdriver antenna on it for rapid HF operation, or do you have to deploy?
We don't have a screwdriver. We do have some ham sticks that'll go on to a well-grounded man on the back.
Yeah.
Was just cost related.
For most HF operation, for a vehicle like that, you're going to be NVIS or, statewide regional. Not Europe,
right.
And Africa,
where, that's
and Asia.
Where we that's where we have that that low OCF.
So 80 meters, 40 meters, 60 meters,
pretty much. But for the HF contesting stuff, the The Tribander at 50 feet is really what plays.
Okay, so it's a contest vehicle, too.
A contest vehicle, too. So like you can't do everything. You can't do every mission well. But here's, let's see, can I share my screens again? Stop sharing system sound. I don't want to share system sound. Share screens. Okay, there we go. You can see this is the Sprinter van I was talking about, the other vehicle that Clay Center owns, not near, where they can connect. This was when we were loading up field day. You can see a tower section in there and a generator and whatnot. We have monitors and computers and a rack there, and that's where you can actually put the operators. That's pretty cool.
Okay, so you can spread out
RF
things to the people, operators.
People can't mess with the RF. The RF can't mess with the people.
Okay.
It's good.
So what kinds of things has it actually done?
And half marathon.
When did this get marathon. Built?
The Sprinter's been around for about 10 years. It's the same body as MCOM 1, actually. Very different mission, though. It was originally built for some NASA projects, and it's kind of been moved over time. And the other van is originally a Wolf Coach 1996, and we received it last year, and we've slowly been outfitting it. Got rid of the holes in the floor and, you know, the animals from inside of it, and cleaned out the mat and the mouse poop from the mast and all that sort of thing.
Yeah, MCOM 1 is designed as an interop vehicle. It's not really designed for local operations.
Right. They don't want people in it. They just need to patch RF. But that's not quite our mission. But it's important to realize that, you know, you don't need to make a vehicle to be like other people's. You need to build what's going to work for you. And I think we've done that quite successfully.
Yeah, we've done a few Ham Radio Now shows with folks who have done MCOM vehicles. We did Dayton's. We did Broward County, Florida. We did some folks out in the Portland area.
Those two are both much bigger versions of what we have here. You know, more like RVs.
Yep. Some of the things we had identified as issues are someone's got to hang on to the thing when it's not in use. You got to have a place to put it that's secure.
Right, which we have.
Maintenance issues. Everyone thinks it would be a fun thing to have.
It's very expensive to have, though.
Yeah, it is. It is a fun thing to have, but there's lots of considerations besides just
liabilities, insurance. Insurance, you know, you have to get the oil changed on it. All the RF systems and, you know, in the winter, I think this winter will be the first year we have it for the winter. We're not going to use it all winter. I plan on actually pulling out a lot of the radios and bringing them inside, you know, because that's easy.
You can't drive it yet, right?
I can't drive it. I don't want to drive it. I'd be scared to drive it. It's pretty sketchy.
What's the driving deal in Massachusetts?
16
now?
And a half for your permit. 16 for your permit, 16 and a half for your license. I could start driver's ed in a month and a half.
You gonna?
Yeah.
Because I hear these days driving is not that big a deal for your generation.
Not for me. I live an hour and a half by train to school. I would love to drive. Ham radio stations are in the boonies. I live in the suburbs.
So you want to drive?
I want to drive. I work for a living. I'd like to buy a car eventually, you know.
Yeah, I guess saying it's too broad a brush to say nobody in your generation wants to drive.
It's not very professional to bike sweating up to like a client job site.
Yeah.
I've had to do that a number of times.
I mean, my generation, back when I got my ham license at 15 and my driver's license the day I turned 16, and it's everybody wanted driver's license back then. And I think we could get a learner's permit at 15. So I was doing all my practicing. I was ready to go. And now I can't wait for self-driving cars because I don't want to drive anymore.
You get one of the, even today, you can already get Tesla Model X will drive itself. It'll get you from its parking spot.
It's actually a self-crashing car.
How many years has Google had the self-driving tuk-tuks under wraps for now?
Well, they're working on it. It's a complex issue.
And then you try and stick a ham radio and put a full gallon Lydia in the back.
And that's my worry.
Yeah.
For one thing, the insurance companies and the manufacturers are going to say, you want to do what with RF in this thing? Do you know how many computers are in here? No, you're not even going to run a handy talkie. We're not happy you're going to run a cell phone.
So what happened? Here's a question. What happens to the handset use laws in California if you're not actually turning the wheel?
Yeah, I don't know if they've caught up with that. But the other thing about the self-driving paradigm is that we won't be owning our own self-driving cars.
Right, of course not.
You
call a self-driving car service and it shows up.
And so who in the self-driving car service fleet is going to offer you a fully equipped ham radio mobile self-driving car?
It might be a very cool niche market. But here's the thing. Does it make sense to have a self-driving mobile service fleet of cars if you still need to have a driver in the front? Just more expensive.
Well, there won't be a driver. Eventually.
Eventually. That eventually is still a long ways away.
Yeah. I mean, their big problem. If we could switch overnight from what we do now to all self-driving, that would be pretty easy. Obviously, there'd be issues.
The issue is mixing the two, to be honest.
Yeah, having self-driving cars with people.
I think the roads would be a lot safer if it was just self-driving cars. Do you know Bostonians were ranked worst drivers this year in the U.S.?
Yay.
Worcester was a close second.
The whole country is going to hell in terms of driving.
Oh, Gary. You're a good driver.
Everyone thinks they're a good driver. Everyone.
I've navigated country roads in the Q-mobile with you.
I drive like an old man.
You're a fine driver.
I drive you have the 5 miles below the speed limit.
You still have, channel 19 on and 2 meters. And
we hardly operated at all. We talked and stuff. We had the opportunity to run the whole Q-mobile, and we hardly did anything.
When I was in it?
When we drove from downtown Dayton out to the Ham
Fest. I got on 40 meters. I played with the 7000. I remember.
A little bit.
I thought your antenna controller was cool.
Although there's better.
I had the automatic.
I had automatic controller envy when I was down at Orlando sitting in the booth next to the guy that builds the automatic controllers.
Was that the guy? Oh, in Orlando. I was going to say in Dayton. I don't think we did.
Yeah. So did you see the Fix-It episode that Jeff and I and David did?
I saw that you put one out, and whenever I see Jeff in a show, I always think I want to watch that. he actually talks about the tech things that Gary doesn't like to edit.
Right. He keeps wanting to do a surface mount soldering show, and we'll do one. He's just got to get it ready.
That is going to require a lot of editing.
Mm-mm. No editing.
No editing. Editing not allowed.
Yeah. Brian, W1CR, just put something
W9CR.
W9CR. Did I say W1?
You said W1.
That's because I associate everybody with the number of the person I'm looking at. He came back from Friedrichshafen, and he says, got a ton of video. Do I want to edit it?
No.
That was my response. No exclamation point. I don't want to edit my own stuff. But I'd be happy to have him on the show to talk about Friedrichshafen.
Hopefully I'm going to go to say it.
Friedrichshafen.
Friedrichshafen, which is in Germany. It's called, the Ham Fest is actually called Ham Radio.
Yeah. In English, right?
Yes. But it's a very nice facility, air conditioned inside. There's no outdoor flea market to walk, all that sort of thing. And next year, it'll line up with the WRTC, the World Radio Sport Team Championship, which is kind of the...
It's also going to be in Germany.
The Olympics of Ham Radio, which is also in Germany.
Don't get used to that saying, that Olympics thing. Those folks are very jealous about their name.
Well, I can say that. I'm not involved.
I can say it. You can say it. They can't say it.
If Chris, DL1MGB, the chairperson of WRTC 2018, came out and said it's the Olympics of Ham Radio, he'd get a nasty cease and desist in the media. Yeah. No.
But the problem is if we all say it, then people think that's what it is. And then when they can't say it, then they are not getting the association everyone else makes.
Really, that is what it is. Call it what you want. People go head to head under fair conditions, and they prove who's best.
Yeah. And you know, we journalists, we can call things whatever they want. I heard a really good example of that, not to stray too far from ham radio.
No politics.
Not really politics. It's just the concept of guilty until proven innocent. And, you know, in the media, if someone hasn't been convicted, it's always alleged. But, you know, you do your alleged.
If you watch the surveillance video of somebody getting shot, is it the alleged murder? It
still is until they've gone through court. But, you know, someone was telling somebody, some journalist or a pundit, more likely a pundit rather than a reporter, because the pundit will say whatever they want. We, by the way, are pundits. If you want to know what a pundit is, you're looking at one in this monitor and one in
this monitor.
That monitor. I said, the guilty until proven innocent, that's a requirement of the government. It's not a requirement of you and me. We don't have to consider someone innocent until proven guilty. I keep saying guilty until proven innocent. It's very hard to think and talk at the same time. The concept of we don't have to consider someone innocent until proven guilty. We can consider them guilty as soon as we want. It's the court that has to think about. Marty's contemplating his future in crime. We old people have screwed up the world, haven't we?
Oh, pretty badly, haven't you? So what's next for Gary and Ham Radio?
I'm trying to get the Florida Repeater Council guys to come on the show and talk to me.
What's the status of that? Are they still trying to kick out all their members? Or?
Well, Brian W9CR and his group held an emergency meeting of the Florida Repeater Council.
I forget. He was the one who was trying to take it over, or he was the one who was previously involved.
Now he was the one who's been complaining that the folks who've been running it have not been. I'll be as charitable as I can be about what he's saying. They haven't been doing a good job. He will say they've been corrupt, and you're pulling your shack down around you.
You can see if you look in the back of my shot, you see this wire moving.
Yeah.
Really very. I have a hair light, and let's see if I can get into the shot. There's a cord that comes down.
Yeah.
I have a.
We're gonna give Marty television show envy. Your phasing line is gonna be a TV show on YouTube.
Soon. I have a stick boom. Let's see if I can get in the shot.
Okay.
Hold the thing out. It goes into a clip. But it's my fidget toy, too. So when it does, I have to fix the shadow. This show is not going to be good for audio. I may not even.
That's what I say. You're going to be a television show pretty soon. So
television shows are way too much. So, I can do interviews that are
on. So Brian and some of his group that have been doing the complaining, they've got enough people that are actually in board positions that they declared an emergency meeting. The folks that were the chairman and secretary, they came, but they did not consider it to be a legitimate official meeting. But in that meeting, Brian and I think Mike is his friend. I should have a list of all the people involved, but I don't. They voted to censure the current board and then to kick all of them out of the office and to install themselves and basically take over. And the old officers say, well, that wasn't a legitimate thing to do.
Sounds kind of corrupt to me, to be honest.
I don't know. In any case, now Brian and his group consider themselves to be the rightful controllers of the Florida Repeater Council. The old guys, kind of hard to say. I'd like to get them on the show and talk to them about it. And they're thinking about it. We swapped email a little bit, so they're thinking about it, but they haven't committed yet.
I don't know. I'm not sure.
So the question is, are they going to say, we give up and you all take over, we're tired of the mess, or are they going to fight to hang on to it?
We will see. We'll see. I appreciate Brian's group's willingness to stand up. Brian's probably saying, you know, I really wish that Marty kid would shut the flip up. Because I remember when we did the Dayton wrap-up show, I kind of went after him about his feedback about Dayton. So,
yeah, because he wasn't real.
He wasn't real really happy, and I voiced my displeasure with his complaint.
He expressed his complaints in a very civil manner. He wasn't one of your trolling, whiny, complainy guys. He just said that these are the issues that he had. And he's a very smart guy, and he knows how to handle himself well.
Sure. Yeah.
So I'm looking forward
to... Unlike somebody on the show.
I'm looking forward to hearing from the Florida Repeater Council guys, and then...
I mean, there's two sides to every story.
Yeah, at least.
So I'd love to hear. You know, it's very interesting. It's kind of out of my league. But it's cool. So, yeah, I don't know. I gotta get back to ham radio. I feel kind of out of it, you know. It's a weird feeling when you get back, when you get your phone after not having it for a month. It's like, what am I forgetting? You know, and I immediately called you.
You were out of phone and out of
email.
Did you have a computer, laptop, or anything?
I got on Google Docs to type some stuff up for some shows and buy some lights, and that was about it.
Okay, so there were computers available.
Not available. I was special.
Okay, so they wanted the campers to be disconnected.
Yes.
I mean, was it a requirement of the camp? Did nobody have their phone?
Yes.
Okay. That'd probably be a good thing for all of us to do once in a while.
You know what, I used to teach a programming class at my school. I used to put a bucket by the door. And on the first day of class, everybody drop your phone in the bucket.
It's a good idea.
If you don't find your phone, if I find your phone, you won't see your phone again for a while. So it's in your best interest to put your phone in the bucket and take it when the class ends. Productivity went up a lot that way.
Yeah. Of course, when I was, you know, going to school, obviously none of those things existed. Cindy and I watched All the President's Men last night, the movie from on the Watergate break-in and the Nixon era thing. This is all before you were born, but it's you know, with talk
you were alive. Do you remember? Oh, yeah. You were just barely old enough to remember.
Watergate. Oh, no, I was 22 years old.
You were in your late teens.
Old. No, it was my early 20s. I wasn't paying a lot of attention. It all kind of washed over me without a lot of really understanding what was happening until I looked at the thing lots later. But the parallels to what's happening right now are strong. And so we wanted to go see that old movie. The weird thing, of course, is no computers, no cell phones, rotary dial telephones. It looked like a terrific anachronism. But
it was simple and things, you know.
Hmm?
There's a well-known COD tester in my neck of the woods, Bob KQ2M, and he still logs with CT on DOS. And his mindset is, if it ain't broken, don't fix it.
Yeah.
So he still logs on DOS.
So,
all right.
My computer is warning me that my VS4 temperature is too high. I'm going to ignore that. It's the VS4 is the card that takes in the signals from the four cameras.
Capture.
It's a conversion, really. I guess capture. It could be a capture. It could record.
It's a Matrox card, isn't it?
Yeah, Matrox.
Matrox.
Yeah, it's serial digital input. These cameras are all HDMI output. And then I have a converter, HDMI to serial digital.
You could probably get away with using HDMI because all your runs are probably what? No more than 15 feet?
Yeah, the reason I got that is because I was doing some conferences and I'd have a run of 50 to 100 feet. And you can run serial digital for a couple hundred feet.
You can run it for 1,000 feet. And you know, after 1,000 feet, you can redo the time sync or whatever it is and... You know, HDMI breaks down.
Yeah. I mean, ham radio now is a high-tech operation.
No, it's just an expensive operation.
Yes.
All this stuff is unnecessary. Gary just does it so he can edit less. Let's be honest.
Yeah. Yeah, if I when I think about how what kind of a ham station I could have for the money that I put into all of this and the editing,
you could have
and
a 7851.
If I never did any television, if it all went into ham radio.
I like the vintage keyboard, by the way, Gary. Very nice.
Yeah, the system came with a keyboard that folded up and covered it up. It's got a handle, you know. It's theoretically it's portable. And I had been working with the keyboard sitting there for a long time, and it was a little bit awkward. And I realized I can take that keyboard off and set a different keyboard there. And I looked around for what I had, and this is what I had. It isn't even USB.
Is it PS2?
Yeah.
It's pretty funny. You know, you have a ham shack back there, you know, Gary. I know you don't use it, but I know it exists.
I use it now and then. The antenna's not connected because we've had thunderstorms.
When was the last time you made a contact?
I refused to testify on the grounds that I may tend to incriminate.
Okay, let me ask you this question. When was the last time you sent out a QSL card?
Oh, I don't do that. That's decades.
Even
I don't have one. And I'd like to think I'm special.
Somebody sent me a QSL card and asked for one in return. And so it's sitting here. Sorry, PT7ZT. See the year on that?
2014. It's been sitting there.
3 years. I haven't mailed it because... Or
PT7ZT. If you're watching this, please send Gary a nasty email.
Take a screen capture.
Print it out.
There's your QSL card.
Because if not, you're not getting that again.
Yeah. I'm sorry. My enthusiasm for QSLing existed for the first few years and then vaporized.
Oh, Gary.
I have an envelope at the bureau. That one probably came from the borough.
How often do you actually get borough cards?
Oh, every few years.
A few years.
I work DX. Look at this. I work DX.
Oh, let's see the dates on those cards.
2013.
Let me pull up my 2017 pile.
2014. I worked Japan. Hiroshima, Japan. What band did I do that on? Was that mobile? It was on 10 meters.
Let's see, switch. This is pretty thick. Let's see if we can get that in the shot. This is a good 8 inches thick. Let's see what we got.
That come from the burrow?
It came from the burrow. JH1 QDF.
QSL burrow guy is happy with you.
Delta Gulf 1 Kilo. I like that call. Kilo Kilo. Juliet November Radio Frequency Yankee.
Show some of the cards for the people on your audio audience that can't see them.
W9OP. Let's see what else we got.
It's got the Three Stooges on there.
Yeah, there you go. J1SKE.
I can't get my voice high enough for Curly. Yeah. Yeah. You ever watch
KG-0 the Stooges? KG-0 Tango Sugar.
Ever watch Three Stooges?
I did not watch. I have not seen that. Here's a nice card, some Canadian. Charlie Fox 3, November, Quebec. I thought this card was funny.
This is fascinating audio.
Yeah, really. I'm not even going to put this out as an audio show. Check this one out, WB5Q.
You decided not to make this a phasing line show?
I think it's, I'll put it up, but,
I mean,
it's going to get an F audio rating.
We have made like 8 or 9 shows as a combined Ham Radio Now and Phasing Line podcast.
You know how many of them I've put up?
None.
I think I've put up 2.
You did the NPOTA.
I put up the NPOTA, and I think I put up... Let's check it out. I think I put out 3 of like the 8. Typically, I'm just too embarrassed. Typically, these shows go so sideways that I'm like, I just can't put it out as content. I don't put out enough content that I can't put out rambling shows, Gary. You put out rambling shows and you put out good content.
What's the difference?
Young people like substance.
Sure.
Substance takes thought and substance takes planning.
I will credit you with... I think I can give you the credit for this. I'm going to dig up here.
The Ann Potash show did well, I think. Let's see. Did well for me. I'm not sure if it did well for you.
It was pretty good. I think because most viewers watched it
from me before.
Listened to it from you, yeah, first. So
I got well over it. I got, I think, 6 or 7,000 downloads on it. That's very good for me.
Oh yeah, that's real good. Yeah, 678 views on YouTube.
Yeah.
So that wasn't huge, but...
that was a good show. The SDR show we did together was a good show.
Yep.
So, that show, did I put that one out? I think I put that one out as... I think I put that one out, yeah. What other shows? We did 3 shows together in Dayton, right? The intro show we did well.
Yeah, 3 interviews and then the intro...
The intro show did well. Pre-Dayton. That was the show with all my screw-ups in it.
We did free-dating, pre-Dayton, the intro, and... okay, that's what I want to look at here.
Yeah, here we go. Here's the Dayton setup day. That did, for you, it did almost 5,000 downloads.
Yeah, that's pretty big. So what I've got on my screen right now are looking at YouTube analytics, but mostly I want to look at this demographics here. And the chart that we're seeing has age breakdowns, 18 to 24. There's a few. 25 to 34, there's a few more.
Decent.
35 to 44, there's a bunch more. Then the big spike is at 45 to 54. Then smaller, 55 to 64, and then... A little smaller yet, 65 plus, which is my demographic. But the thing about that is that since I've been doing shows with you and Sterling and some of the other younger guys, the younger part of that graph has grown. It used to be the 65 plus was the big spike, and it just kind of went down linearly from there. And now it's down 20 years. So since the overall audience hasn't grown that much, it's pretty much we are pissing off the old timers and attracting some of the younger people.
I get a fair amount of hate from the old. I get a lot more hate from your audience than I do any other audience.
Oh, good. Thanks, audience. Yeah, there was a guy on making comments, I think on YouTube or QRZ, this is Lose the Kid.
It was more than one guy.
Yeah, a few.
There's a few guys. Probably a dozen.
Yeah, but my response was I'd rather lose you as an audience member than the kid. The kid stays.
The kid stays.
Yes, because you are the past of amateur radio. And
I'm the past. I'm gonna not you. I'm gonna die off.
The old curmudgeon is the past of amateur radio. You are the future.
The future of amateur radio.
Amateur radio. Am I anywhere near putting in my echo? You can't hear the echo, I don't think. It doesn't come down the line back to you.
Skype has good echo cancellation.
But and it doesn't go out to the Facebook folks either. Oh, too bad. Won't be heard. And whenever I do Future of Amateur Radio, it is the future
of amateur radio. But, where's the reverb?
Yeah, but the effects on the future of amateur radio. The effects thing on the mixer doesn't go out the mix minus lines to you or to Skype. It might go to, yeah, it goes to Facebook. Yeah, the Facebook folks. The Facebook folks are hearing the echo.
Travelocity presents the roaming.
You're not being echoed. Why aren't you being echoed?
Echo. Echo. My name is Marty Soloway. The show has totally lost. Oh, well, now I can hear myself and I can try and, you know, I'm going to just have to talk with both headphones off. There we go. So now I can't hear you. So if I don't like what you're saying, I actually don't care anymore.
So Marty can't hear me. The password I don't want to know what you're saying. Marty can't hear me.
I can't hear you at all. Now I can hear you. My FB is working now.
Is there anybody watching us on Facebook? I haven't looked.
There are. I don't know why. I really don't know why.
They've got no life.
If you're watching me, you have no life. That's for sure. We were up at like 10 or 11. Five people.
I just had to refresh. Yep, there's five. Of course, one of them is me and one of them is you.
No.
So that leaves three.
Andy Cowley, the Echo Sad Good. Neo Rapp, lose the Beofang. Not the kid. I like it. Best comment. I think that's the best comment of the day.
Oh, no, David. David is answering. David, are you out there? I'll see if I can add David to the call.
I already did. You beat me.
Because this show has gone down the tubes anyway.
I'm going to try something here.
You're going to try to get Sterling?
So David said no.
And you disappeared.
Or is that a yes?
I don't know.
Sterling. Oh, Sterling. He's busy. Busy for me. All right. I think they don't care about us. Oh, is that David?
Hi, yeah. Marty.
Hi, you David. How's dinner?
It was good.
Wait, don't forget.
Wait, I can't see you guys though.
What are you in there? You in a restaurant or something?
Shaved ice.
What are you, is your dad driving you crazy tonight?
Welcome. What's that?
Did you got the panel there?
Yeah, we got the panel. The girls just finished a show and we were going out for shave ice. I saw you guys recording. Welcome back from camp.
Thank you.
Are you still doing a show?
Yeah, we're still on.
We're still on the internet. It's a show. It just means we're talking.
Still on the internet. All right. Well, welcome to the mobile studio. I can't see you guys, but I can hear you.
Yeah. You have the, all you need is the mount in the car and you can do shows at 70 miles an hour.
I have the mount in the car. Oh, wait. Gwenny's coming too. It's going to be the whole kit and caboodle here.
Yeah.
No, I can't put it in the thing there. Hold on, guys.
And the wind noise.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
Because the air conditioning blows right on the speaker. How's that? Is that better?
That's better.
Yeah.
Or do you guys hear yourself?
The big problem is you need to turn the phone sideways, and your mount probably won't let you do that.
Yes, only because of the radios.
How many radios? Let's see the mobile install.
That's the mobile install. And the phone goes there. So give me
okay,
your
you're not pointing at the mobile install. Almost. But you're not pointing at the mobile install.
This way?
I see the bungee cord. I see a bungee cord or something like
that. Oh, I see a bungee. Wait. Here. Can you see it now?
No.
Yeah, we're looking out the window.
Okay, don't move. Oh, it's right there.
What the hell's the big orange thing?
Yeah.
That's my dashboard. The orange thing's the dashboard.
This?
What kind of vehicle are you in?
It's a Toyota FJ. Here, hold that. I can't see that.
There's the peanut gallery in the back.
Why are you not sending me video?
Peanut gallery?
Where's the video?
Where's the video? Why aren't I sending
it? It's all on my head. It's all
just give the can. Just give the camera to Gwen. She's entertaining.
Just right. Hang up and try again.
Wait, it says headset on.
Oh, there we go.
Okay.
Yay.
Here we go. You guys are going to go for a drive with me. And they're going to look at you. I will not look at you while I drive. Because this, I don't know if this really breaks the California hands-free because we're...
Hello.
We were just talking about that earlier in the show. Does the hands-free apply to self-driving cars?
You know, here's the bigger question for the self-driving car. When the self-driving car gets in an accident, whose insurance does that go against?
I think it should go against the manufacturer of the car.
Well, that's an interesting question.
I think it should be the driver because it should be ready for an accident.
But it's a self-driving car.
Well, the driver's not driving.
Okay, peanut gallery, shut up.
With the way you drive, you might need a self-driving car, David.
No, I'd love to drive.
I'm hoping that the insurance companies are battling that out right now so they can get it figured out because they'll figure it out.
Well, because I'm not, you know, I would not be actually the driver.
Yeah.
Driving it. I might be the operator.
I don't know.
It's an interesting conundrum.
Wait, are we live?
Yes, we're live on the internet.
Oh, hi, guys.
Stick your head in here, Gwenny. You can say hi.
Hello.
Is your dad being nice to you today?
Yeah, he took pictures of us during our show, which is my dog awesome. Colorful? He gets, don't do that.
Is he now just trying to bribe you with food?
Put your tongue back
I'm trying to get him to buy his food because I'm hungry.
Oh, I just had shit.
No, I spent the last 4 hours taking over 1,000 pictures.
I spent the last 7 hours after.
Are you starving your children?
No, I just fed them dinner.
No, you fell asleep, guys. I want dinner.
So, what was the show topic? Wait, actually, more important than that, how was camp, Marty?
I missed camp. It was lovely.
But you didn't bring any radios, huh?
I brought a single ICOM handy talkie.
Okay.
Don't go anywhere without my ICOM handy talkie.
Yes. I agree. I'm the same way. Soon my kids will do that too.
And it came with me all the way to Acadia National Park in Maine. And it was faithful to me. And
Was it Temple Camp or some other camp?
It was a Jewish summer camp, yes.
Oh, okay, cool.
Okay, you should be getting video back now.
I'm trying to drive. I keep seeing it flash around, but I'm not.
We're working on it.
All right. Yeah, cool. I'll let you guys debate shaved ice. I'm going to go to sleep.
You have junior operators there.
I'm in there for you.
They're late. It's like 11 o'clock.
Is Gwenny in a child seat in the back, sir?
No, it's just
not
the, tall. It's just the she angle. It's the angle of the.
It looks like you're in a toddler seat there.
Yeah.
Maybe your dad should be in a toddler seat. You know, that way they can have the maturity, the restraint.
I think Juan's the one who's definitely supposed to be in the toddler seat.
It's the angle of the mobile studio. The phone is canted back at an angle.
Where's the production vehicle?
Oh, no, this is just, you know, this is my regular.
Every time I say production vehicle, there's somebody at Dara who's probably screaming at me.
You, I think.
Production vehicle is Marty's code word for sneaking in an extra car into the parking lot.
Got it. Oh, yeah, right. For the AC100, this will be the production vehicle.
Okay.
For the race we're going to do in a couple weeks.
No, but you have to understand, you have to have the production vehicle, and then you have to have the talent vehicle.
Yeah, no, we bring our MCOM trailer, because I heard you guys talking about MCOM trailers when the show's over. We're going to bring ours. I'm going to try to do some filming in there, because we have one. And then my car will be the production trailer, or production vehicle.
We're gonna do some filming.
Actually, we're doing for the. I hope that this works out, but for that race, Gwen and I are going to be the ATV crew.
I think I see the back.
Who's driving?
Dad.
I'm driving.
David Goldenberg WZOTH.
I don't know who's a better driver.
Than who?
You're Gwen.
No, Gwen's still 13.
Right, but what does that mean? I don't know.
She's not driving
it
yet.
It means that we have like two more years until she's alone.
I'm really good at the
Autopia. Yeah. Autopia,
can you drive a go kart?
Yes.
Yeah. Never
then tried. It's just the same thing. Just your dad's life matters. So if he's mean to you, you can push him off.
Sure.
Absolutely.
You know, so this, you know these FJs have eject buttons in them too, right?
What did I miss on the latest version of the phasing line?
This is the latest
version of the phasing line. Absolutely nothing so far.
I saw Neil was in the chat room. Did you guys get Neil on, or he was just fly on the walling?
You know, let me see if Neil's out there.
Oh, he was heavy in the chat room. The thing is, you guys got to watch the chat room because there's a lot of.
That's why we have you.
Right. I missed the show.
I already did it.
But I was on. I was on airplane mode because we were in a theater where the kids were. Yeah.
We're following the rules. There was a small child. No, that child. I wanted to smack.
When we're on live TV. Where's that 12-second delay now we were talking
call
about?
Call the other account, Gary.
Hey, okay. Marty, are you running OBS or did you get a TriCaster?
What?
Are you running OBS?
I'm not doing any of the switching. That's on Gary's end.
Yeah. Okay. But do you have Wirecast or do you have OBS?
I have Wirecast.
Yeah, what?
Yeah. And by the way, Marty, the reason we've got these, I've got these titles, is that you embarrassed me into figuring out how.
What? Because I could do it and you couldn't.
Right.
Wait, the kid isn't supposed to be able to do more than the old man.
Oh, you can do so much more than me.
There's the young man.
Hey, Neil.
Howdy.
There you are.
Here he is.
Somewhere. Maybe.
Now you're going to make
there we go.
You're going to make me do a title for you.
I got to have the fly-in noise, though. I have to have the fly-in noise.
It has to go Ham Talk Live. The third
person. No, you got to have the...
Are you sure?
No, there it is.
Yeah, the folks on the output hear it. You folks on the line don't hear it so much.
This is Neil wants to kill us all. David's driving down the road. Gary looks thinks like, he's a technical director, and I'm just tired.
Looks like Neil got promoted to being an adult film star.
Oh wow.
Watch it now. We're on live TV.
Are you sure Neil's name isn't guest to name XXXXXXX?
Right.
So, yeah. I get it.
Oops, I'm typing in the wrong place.
I'm gonna control myself and not make any live TV.
All right. You guys are going to lose me in about...
What?
You're going to lose me in about 500 yards.
Uh-oh.
Probably.
Getting out already.
Well, there's a cell drop-off area there, and I think, but I don't know. I could be wrong.
You know, I'm actually probably the least active person right now. I haven't made a contact in over a month. Even Neil's probably more active than I am.
Wait, you brought your icon, but you didn't get out to camp.
I got my 13 colonies, finally.
I've never been in town while that was happening. I've always been away. Never been in town for IRU. Never been in town for all that stuff.
And we rock field day.
Yeah, I heard.
How's that, Neil? Have I got it right?
What?
Have I got that right? Your title stuff?
I can't see that. I see David, and that's it.
Marty, my return's going out, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Yep, you got it. Yeah, the main part of my screen is just spinning. Not sure what's up.
I think I'm going to spin myself to bed, guys.
I think that's my driving.
Oh, is that it? It's David's driving.
All right. I'm going to spin myself to sleep, guys. I'm tired.
This is all your fault, Marty. You can't leave yet.
Wait a minute. This is this Marty's show?
Yeah.
How can he leave if it's his show?
I think Gary kind of took my show away.
This is your show.
So could I tell you guys to go now?
Well, I guess. Not a very nice host. Okay, Neil. By the way, Neil, the last time you were on, I was having all kinds of Skype issues and everything was freezing and all. That's all been fixed.
Neil had Skype issues.
I yelled at Skype for about 2 months and they finally got my issue fixed.
I can't.
Which one
I found the key. You have to complain on Twitter.
Well, I can't blame Skype. It was my fault. It was a bad router. So I swapped out the router, bought a new one. Everything is fine. Everyone's studio quality.
Nice.
Your studio quality.
Yeah. Looks good. Sounds
Gary,
good.
Gary, I got a proper camera. So now you're going to like a nice shot with depth of field and I'll have the blurry backdrop back here.
Is that David trying to come back in there? Sounds like it.
I heard a car door.
So we are putting W5KUB absolutely to shame in terms of a rambling show that goes nowhere.
Awkward.
Well, but we've got good title graphics on this one, right?
Yeah, we do.
I beat him for the title. I already had the fading title graphics. He has me beat with the swooping in thing.
Oops.
Yeah, I gotta have that flying noise. It's just
hang on, I can do it.
You're talking to Mr. Audio, the guy who puts compressors on his repeater.
That's right.
Did you hear it,
guys?
No, I didn't hear it.
Okay, I'll make it.
Must not be on the return.
It's just not loud because it.
All right. Rush. It's bedtime, boys.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. Okay. Now we're good.
But that mean that this is a Phasing Line show, not a Ham Radio Now show. So
yeah, so go to my website, phasinglinepodcast.com, click the donate tab. I know you're probably really stupid.
Wait a minute.
Oh, look at this.
You're
this is a great
shot. You're asking people to donate for this?
Yes.
Okay.
Actually, what he's asking people is to not withdraw their existing donations.
So I lost half my donations this summer. It's no joke.
Oh, David, you look great. Your studio quality there.
Yes, because I'm in the studio.
So let's shame those people into giving me money. And don't go to Gary's website. Gary's greedy and has enough money. Neil's smart enough not to ask money, and David has more important things to do than to think about money.
You ask for money, don't you, Neil?
No. Yeah. Oh. No, we do. We do some ads. We just keep the costs low enough to where it doesn't hurt too much.
You're not part of the Begging for Funding Foundation?
Yes, I'm not a part of the foundation.
Do you consider yourself a sink or a dink? You're a dink.
Are you talking to me?
Talking to Neil.
Yeah.
Lots of kids.
Neil's a dink.
Oh, Neil.
So, wait a minute. So, is that BFF?
The Begging for Funding Foundation, yeah.
Yeah. We got to have a TLA for it. So,
oh, the BFF, yeah.
That's the BFF.
BFFF.
Yeah.
The B triple F.
TLA. Oh, three-letter acronym. Okay, I had to Urban Dictionary that one.
You hadn't heard of a TLA? An FLA?
Four-letter, three-letter?
Yeah.
I go to a school that we pride ourselves on acronyms.
I went to the airport and had to go through the TLA to get on the airplane.
Yeah.
So the Begging for Funding Foundation was founded by Arvin back there, but it was inspired by Bob Heil. I got to give him credit.
I heard you say that.
I kept my mouth shut on that.
If you go look at it was actually not a Ham Nation show. It was a amateur logic show of the Ham Nation gathering at Dayton, and so. Bob is at the lectern going into this little rant, and the rest of the folks that are on the stage are all on camera, and they're going, I don't know.
Yeah, they look a little uncomfortable.
First, they're kind of smiling, and this is funny, and then, oh, where is this going? Do I want to be part of this? Can I leave now? Tamitha Scove is like, what?
Can I offer some acronyms that'll blow Neil away? These are all from my school. Uh-oh. The first one is Ship Thick, Super Helper, Honor Butter, Task Helper, Keeper.
Sure.
Shrept.
Okay.
Study Hall, Reading, Elective, and Project Time. That's another one. What's another good ones we have? I'm trying to think. Shawasa.
Not King Philip called out 50 good soldiers?
No. Shawasa, simple human experiment with a strong statistical analysis. Say that fast 5 times. Dreamis, doing research in math and science. What's another good one?
Neil, what do you guys use these days for the color code? Because you can't use the one I learned.
I use the app. Yeah, you can't use the one I learned either.
We can modify that. Bright boys,
especially since that's my aunt's name.
You could still use bad boys. I don't think bad boys is bad.
No, bright boys respect our young girls because Violet.
See, that's my aunt's name.
Violet.
So I got to watch that one.
I'm stuck for a verb now. For Violet does something willingly, or maybe we can
giggles.
There you go.
Giggles.
Bad boys.
Bright boys respect our young girls.
Bright boys respect our young girls, but
because,
vicious, grapes.
Good luck with that.
I have nothing left.
You guys out there on Facebook, keep working on it.
Black, brown, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet, gray, white.
Right there.
And I'm not going to say what it stands for, because I'm a young boy, it would look very bad.
Yeah. All the old hams know what I was talking about. Oh, I still got the begging for funding thing up here. I don't need that.
I think bad boys are young girls, and they can yell. They can fill in the rest. So. Neil, you ready for the fall? You ready to start teaching again?
I am ready for summer vacation now.
You've been teaching summer school?
No. I've been running dad everywhere.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, sympathy and all that stuff because you lost your dad recently. And your dad was your ham radio mentor, not just your dad, that makes an awesome dad.
Yep.
WB9.
UKG, Uncle King George.
Uncle King George.
So he only became a ham shortly before you did.
Yeah, actually, the reason that I am not WB9 UKH is
you can't sign your name.
Couldn't sign my name on the 610. I printed it because I didn't know how to sign my name. And so it got delayed.
So is this almost 42 years in ham radio?
It was 41 the day he died.
Wow.
Yeah. But yeah, since school got out, I've been running him to doctors and hospitals and everything pretty much full time. So summer vacation starts tomorrow.
We don't handle that end of life thing very well.
No, we don't.
Yeah.
And when I get to that point, I may change my tune. You know,
they still won't handle it well again.
Right.
So, yeah. So we got the funeral done yesterday. We went and bought a case for the flag today. And tomorrow starts life again. So yeah.
I was just down visiting my 97-year-old stepmom today.
Wow.
And I mean, that she's had a really great long life, but about 3 years ago, she started slipping into dementia. And now she knows who I am. She knows who Cindy is, but she can't live on her own. And she had been totally independent until 3 years ago.
That's the way mom was.
Dementia is, I mean, it's just horrible. That it robs bright, capable people of their ability to, you know, Marty, this is so much on the other end of life from where you are, but a lot closer to where we are, especially me.
Gary, you realize you're 25 years older than Neil. 20 years old.
All right. So just me.
Yeah. Mom had dementia too. And it was very difficult to see her that way.
How old was your mother?
To call an HT a watermelon. What?
Yeah. I think she still makes sense. And you try to get them to make sense and they're just not going to. So we pretty quickly learned you just go with what, you know, what's going on.
Exactly.
She has a very busy life inside her mind.
Yep.
How old was your father?
Mine was 84. 84.
So he beat the actuarial tables a little bit.
He did. He beat the tables. But leukemia does not mess around. It was about 2 months.
Yeah, I lost my dad to thyroid cancer. He was 79, so he was right on the actuarial table. Yeah.
So I have an entire ham shack to take apart and all of my old stuff needs to get moved back. So we filled the SUV with photo albums, with mom's photo albums. We got about a third of them.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow.
You got some scanning to do.
Well, I've got some scanning to do, and I've got a lot of moving to do.
I wish I could come up that way and give you a hand.
Well, I appreciate it, but it might be a little bit of a commute.
Uber's that far kind of expensive.
So was American Airlines.
But I did find this. I haven't pulled out the tape player yet.
Sony. Centron.
Do you even know what that is, Marty?
No clue.
You really show that again, Neil.
I know what the tape is. I don't know what Centron.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see what I wrote on it.
NA, which I'll assume is North America.
North America.
I can't read it.
Hold it still. Don't shake it.
Tell us something.
Teleconference net.
Net. It says net.
1983. Okay.
1983. Yeah.
Was that pre-Newsline. If it works. So that was my golden find yesterday.
Westlink thing?
Yes.
So not North. What was the... I'm trying to think of the name of the North American... What was the name of the thing that Gordon... The net that Gordon West ran? It was North American something.
He did something on 40 meters. West Coast.
No, the school thing he did.
Oh,
what is it called?
Don't remember.
Yeah, I forget what the 10-meter school net, but I forget what the name of it was. Was it a NARL thing? North American Radio League?
Maybe, I don't know.
There was a NARL at one point.
We could do a whole other show on the. Okay, I'm not gonna be diplomatic for a minute. The scam that is WA2. JKJ.
Yeah, WA2 or B2.
Oh.
That was the right music.
Yeah, that was the right music.
And I use the word scam because that's definitely the right term.
Well, I've had him on the show once, and I don't know. I hear rumors. You are rumor central.
Oh, I start.
Yes, Marty is rumor central.
Remember when we were talking about alleged and innocent until proven guilty and that we pundits can say anything?
Oh,
However, you do have to be prepared to be sued.
if I get a lot, mean, one so, side of the debate here is I can say so many stupid things, but who wants to sue a 15-year-old?
They'll get your $7,300.
Yeah.
No, they'll get mom and dad's money first.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I'm gonna call it a night. I just gotta pass the note for my production.
David, you gotta talk a little longer because I got your title now.
Let me
woohoo!
Go to bed, Marty. Long day.
There's my
tomorrow.
Title. You had that in the other show too, Gary.
All right.
This is the first sort of.
We're gonna wrap it up.
Sort of a show.
That's Rambling my show. Job.
Do you want to pitch for money?
Me?
Go to arnewsline.org. Where? What are we?
No. We're not ready.
Neil. Okay. Because if I were to pitch for money,
but he said he was going to wrap it up.
Yeah, so that's right. That's
my job.
That's your. Right. That's your shtick.
Kill the stream. Yeah.
Kill the stream.
All right.
So good
night, everybody.
Everybody say goodbye. Facebook. Over. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm
Marty Sullivan, KC1CWF.
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And I'm somebody. Neil Rapp, WB9VPG.
Over.
And
out.
Exclamation point.
There you go.